the west, gonna take my money, head out to the west, gonna make my fortune doing what I do best.
Oh Lord, gonna spend my time doing what I do best.
Got a job on the railroad, on the northern line up near Big River. On the northern line, gonna stay right here until I've done my time.
Oh Lord, gonna stay right here till I've done my time.
In Saskatchewan, where the winters are cold, and the railroad man is longing for gold, and the radio's playing songs about the west. And when the daylight fades and the work is done, we'll get those fiddles out and play those songs. Gonna fill my glass and make music till the dawn. Say I do, couldn't live without her. Couldn't say I do. Gonna marry my sweetheart before the summer is through.
Oh Lord, gonna marry before the summer is through.
Got a job in the city, on the factory floor, down in the city, on the factory floor. Gotta feed my own children and my cousins four. Gonna work it out and work some more. Oh Saskatchewan, where the winters are cold.
Found religion, found it on my knees. Gonna pray real hard until I'm free. Oh Lord, gonna pray real hard until I'm free.
In Saskatchewan, where the winters are cold, and the railroad man is longing for gold, and the radio's playing songs about the
That's a nice song, isn't it? That's a new group. I haven't heard them before. It's called they are called Viper Central, and that's a new album, which is called, let me just check what that is, Thump and Howl. And that's a track called Saskatchewan. Good morning. Do you know what I did this morning? You're not going to believe what I did.
Sorry.
Hello? Sorry.
Yes.
Oh, I didn't realise you were doing something else.
I was talking,
I thought you might have been listening to the programme.
No, I was talking to Janet.
Is Janet in today?
Yes.
Hello, Janet.
Mm-hmm.
We normally have Emma. Uh-huh. Emma's not today. So what is Janet all right?
Yes, no, it was her headphones was rubbing against the back of my leg, and I thought for a second it was some sort of animal.
That's you only know. Janet. Do you know what I did today? I did something very weird. Do you know the way every once in a while I have bits and pieces of paper that I bring down with me, little requests, little bits and pieces that I should remind myself to talk about? Well, I lifted the pieces of paper and I brought them down to me, and as I opened the record thing and I played the record and I looked down, I'm just looking at the piece of paper. Do you know what? I have my bank statement. Now, here's the thing that people would like to see.
A lot of reading in that.
Don't you be so sure.
Mm-hmm.
I could read this out. No, I'm not going to read it out. I lifted the wrong bit of paper. I've got my bank statement here. So I'm not going to read my bank statement. I'm not going to bother. But you see, there are people who would pay money to hear this. I have a great story that I can't tell you. I have a great story that I cannot tell you.
What's it about?
I can't even tell you that. I can't even tell you that. It's the greatest story ever. And do you see, if I told you the story that I
When did you hear the story?
That was last week.
All right.
I've been keeping it under wraps.
Is it about a bank?
No, it's about a person.
About a person?
A person well-known, a well-known
in Northern
person.
Ireland?
All over the place. Big,
big international star.
Not international, Britain.
Right, you know? Okay, yeah. Right, right. Singer?
No, no.
Actor?
No, no.
A TV presenter?
Well, part-time.
Part-time? Yeah. Comedian?
No. It all depends where you look at it.
Right.
No, I can't. No, don't push me any further, Sean. I just know screen.
Male?
Allegedly.
Yes.
More or less. More or less.
I'm not going any further.
No, don't go any further. No, this is
I'll
a wrong place to go.
Yes,
it's a wrong place to go.
I'll drop
but it's
it,
the greatest story. And I would give anything to be able to tell this story. And I know it to be absolutely true. And it's not only interesting, it's funny. It's got everything. Do you know the way you get a story and it's got everything? It's got...
Will it be in the public domain sometime?
Never.
No, never.
Never. If it is, the guy's finished.
Well, would you tell me and Janet after the programme?
No. No, because what's the point of telling you things that after the programme? Do you remember that movie that Nicole Kidman was in, and she was a TV presenter, she was a weather girl? It was called... I can't remember what it was called, but she was a weather girl, ruthless, wanted a career in television. And then somebody said to her one time, why don't you do this particular thing? It was a kind of a nice, kind of charitable act. She could have done something nice for a person. I said, why don't you do that? She said, what's the point in doing it? Well, it's not going to be televised. Mm. You see, that's what I think. What's the point in telling new stuff if it's not on the radio? What's the point of doing anything if everybody knows about it? If nobody knows about it, what's the point? Anyway, but I would love to tell you. I just see your face. I don't want to see your face, but I just like to see your face light up. I'd like to see Janet. I'd like to see Janet's jaw drop. I'd like to see Janet's jaw drop. Go on, say Janet's jaw drop.
Janet's jaw drop.
I couldn't say that. Anyway, I'm going to start the programme now.
Janet says I'm right and you're wrong.
About what?
But your holiday, you're here next week, she says.
I am not here
you
next
week. You are. Janet's right, and I'm right. You're not away next week.
Well, hold on a second. Let me prove it to you.
Mm-hmm.
When I come in here on Monday morning, I won't be here. Then you'll know that I'm gone.
But Janet says you will.
I'll not be here.
You're not logged
I'm out of here on
you're
Friday.
You're not logged out in her book.
I'm out of here on Friday.
You're not.
I am. I don't care what's in her book. I'm out of here on Friday, then we'll be back for 2 weeks. And you're doing next week, and Jerry Kelly's doing the week after that. Isn't that right?
That's if you're away next week.
According to my book tells me I'm going to be away. And my book has made arrangements. My book has bought plane tickets. My book is going to fly out of here on Monday. Right? And Janet's book, stay in here. But Janet's book is not right. Let me just start the program.
I'll never forgive you and Michael Bradley.
For what?
Something just occurred to me there now when you're talking about film and you're talking about that weather gear.
Yes.
We're in America.
Uh-huh.
And we're in... Where were we? We're in California.
California, yes.
I'm trying to think where we were.
California, yeah.
Right. Yeah. And here you're out in California and there's beautiful sunshine.
Yeah. Women trying to get at me.
Right.
Yeah.
And you and Michael Bradley drag me
mm-hmm.
to a picture house.
Yeah. Movies. Yeah.
And in the afternoon.
Yeah.
And we go into and all these Americans that are there, of course, and they're all eating popcorn and that was the start of the whole thing annoying me.
What's this you call that place? Let me just remember. Hollywood, isn't that a Hollywood? Isn't that where they make the movies?
Was it Hollywood? I'm not
it
sure.
It was Hollywood, yeah.
Are you sure?
I'm positive.
What was the name of the horrible film that you took me to?
I can't remember.
You and Mickey Bradley were excited about it. You read about it in the paper.
Was it not the one we went to in...
Where?
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Was not that the
one we went to in New York with all the girls in it? You're not thinking about that?
No.
Well, the one
what was the one in New York?
I'll tell you what it was. It was
I know who was in it.
I know, but I know the name of the film.
So do I.
Why don't you tell me?
You tell me.
A Kiss Before Dying.
That's correct. You two dragged me to that horrible, horrible film.
Well, it was over
Sean Young or somebody.
Sean Young.
Aye.
And another person.
It was dreadful.
It was pretty bad. Oh, no.
Yeah. Where was that?
Pardon?
Where did we go?
It was Hollywood.
Was it Hollywood?
Hollywood Boulevard.
I can't get over that. And we go there in an afternoon.
But you haven't lived. I mean, how many people can say that? They went to the movies in Hollywood.
It was dreadful.
I know, but that's not the point. Will you let me start the programme? Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great privilege to be here. If you want to call me, the number to ring, and after all...
Somebody would need
to... Can't you hear me doing the spiel?
No, this, I'm gonna turn this, you down. This is important. Somebody would need to do something about Bill Clinton's wife. What do you call her?
Hillary. She needed to do her hair.
Somebody would need to do something about Hillary Clinton's hair.
And she's starting to walk funny as well.
Why don't you do something about it in your TV program?
I don't have a TV program.
Your TV program about hair.
Oh, that one. No, it's too late now. It's almost done. Let me do the spiel.
Why won't that girl get her hair sorted out?
Because she doesn't have to get her hair sorted out. She's the Secretary of State. Everybody does what she says. Nobody's going to say to her, oh, for God's sake, Hillary, do something with your hair. Nobody's going to say that to the Secretary of State. That's why nobody ever says to somebody, I don't like that wig of yours. Nobody ever said that. Nobody ever says that. You might say it to the window cleaner or something, but you're not going to say it to the man who's in charge of you.
Oh, well, I would say, I'm sure there's people there, makeover people who advise them about what they wear.
Maybe she just doesn't care, Sean. Maybe she doesn't care about glamour and that kind of thing. Let me do the spiel now. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
She always looks ever so tired with bags.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Welcome. Janet has a call.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the programme. The number to ring if you want to contact this programme. After all, your calls are important to us. 08459 555678. I've just been told by my assistant that a caller is already waiting to talk to me.
Yes, Margaret.
So there's the proof. The email address is jerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk and the text messaging service is 81771 for those of you who wish you were somebody else. Hello, good morning.
Hello, Jerry.
And Margaret, hello, good morning.
Good morning, Jerry. Jerry, this is Margaret speaking. Jerry, it's about a collie dog that one of the children has.
Yes.
And he is about 14-year-old.
Sorry, I missed that. What was that? What did you say?
He's about 14-year-old. Yes. About 13 or 14-year-old.
Okay.
And he went to the vet the other day and he had 3 teeth taken out. But when he came out of the local anaesthetic, he has took a slight stroke.
Oh, dear.
And, but his head was a wee bit twisted, but it's coming around. But since then, he's sort of lost balance of his back leg. You see, he suffers also from arthritis.
Arthritis?
I think I know what that is.
Yes.
What?
What are you,
a vet?
No, but the same thing happened to our RIP.
Before it was executed?
Yeah. No, honestly, Margaret, I had a dog and his back legs went. Uh-huh. Stop you laughing. Our RIP's back legs went. And it was as if he was on... It was, you know, on a rocking horse.
Yeah.
Up and down and up and down. And if you tapped him at all on his bum, no, in his
he's asking for money or something.
His
like
hind quarters, like the poor thing lost its balance.
Why would you tap his bum?
No, just to test his balance.
Yeah.
And it was up and down, just rocking up and down all the time. Apparently that's rickets. What are you? No, you need to take your wee dog back to the vet.
All right, then. I may seem as if I have no sympathy, but I'm just, you know...
What?
I don't know. It's just the way I am. I'm sorry, Margaret. I know I'm showing...
I don't think there's any cure for that, Margaret, but I don't know.
Don't be telling Margaret there's no cure for her dog.
Take it back.
He's not a vet. Don't listen to him. It's because he had a dog...
You know, there's a cure for... There's really cures for everything now, Jerry.
And he's poking his dog in the arse with a finger.
Pardon?
He's the man. He's poking his dog in the arse with his finger.
No, I just...
You can't... Take a man like that seriously? There's cures for everything. So you say, let me start again. He's got arthritis, right?
He has arthritis.
Okay.
And he had a slight stroke. Yes. And he's off balance due to the stroke. Is there anyone that would have a cure or any kind of a remedy that we could try?
You've obviously gone to the vet.
He has been with the vet.
Yeah, but have you been...
Can you hear me talking to
him? It's not vertigo.
What?
It's not vertigo. You can rule that out.
We can rule vertigo out, apparently.
Oh, I wouldn't think it's vertigo.
All right, then.
So it wouldn't.
Okay. You say it had some teeth out. There would be a connection there.
It had 3 teeth. The vet says, you know, that stroke could be down to stress. You know, maybe he has been scared or coming to the vet or something like that. It's due to stress,
Did you tell it was going to the vet? I mean, did it know it was going to the vet?
Well, it knew whenever it went to the vet, for it had been there before and it maybe had a bad experience of being at the vet before.
Is he a dog? Would you not call a dog's teeth fangs? Would you not?
No.
What's a fang?
A fang would have you think a wolf would have a big.
But what's a dog?
I know. I know what you're saying, but it's more friendly, isn't it?
Dog's teeth doesn't sound right.
No, but if you see it's a
fang. You say, look at the fangs.
Bearing his fangs.
Fangs.
Yeah. Doesn't sound fangs. Nice. Doesn't sound good.
Anyway, listen.
I would take that wee dog back to the vet.
Take the wee dog back to the vet. And I'll tell you what we'll do, Margaret. If anyone rings us and maybe perhaps has some idea of what might be wrong with the dog or what may help you, we'll either give them your number or whatever. Okay?
That'd be brilliant, Sean. That might be, or Jerry, I'd be much appreciated.
Mm-hmm. What kind of a dog is it? What make of it? What make is
it? It's a collie.
A collie, you told me, yeah. All right. My attention span is getting very slim. All right, then. Thank you very much indeed.
No problem, Jerry. Thank you very much. Now.
Thank you very much. I know I didn't show as much sympathy there as I should have. Yes. I'm aware that people are thinking now that I may be callous and cold-hearted.
No,
I don't know.
No, there's only one thing for that dog. That dog must go back to the vet.
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
Dear Puppet Chin, do you know what Alan Simpson did yesterday?
He did a programme between 3 and 5.
Don't be so cheeky. He talked over the lead break on Hotel California. That is unforgivable. Do they teach nothing at DJ school these days? That's Jonathan Sims who writes, inflamed, incensed, furious at a man talking over the guitar solo in Hotel California. Does he not know any better? Even Cat's Eye wouldn't do that. That's you, middle of the road. That's what he calls you, Cat's Eye Coin, because you're middle of the road music. Well, there are certain intros and guitar breaks that you never talk over. I want you to give me one now. You're a DJ, you're a man who's a wee program in the afternoon.
Right.
But I've heard you doing stuff.
What?
Unforgivable stuff.
Well, tell me.
What is it?
There are times when you don't talk.
I never talk.
You talk sometimes.
Yeah, I never.
You do. You might come in the middle of something.
I do not. I have never come in.
If you were playing All Right Now.
I never come in the middle of anything.
Would you come in the middle of All Right Now when the guy's going
no.
And say, Margaret Dini is 43 today?
Not at
would
all.
Would you do that?
No,
I think you would.
No, you do not.
Things you don't talk over. All Right Now by Free. Sweet Home Alabama. You don't talk over that. You don't talk over. What's that? Layla. You don't talk over Layla. There's certain intros and guitar breaks. Never. No doubt you'll think of others. You never talk over. Oh, there's one that I love.
So what about the song that you talked over? You talked over a song. Now, this is the reverse.
That's only Phil Coulter.
No, I'm not talking about that. This is the reverse of what we're talking about now.
Yes.
You talked over the lyric, and then there was a guitar solo.
Yes.
And you said, that's the best part of the whole... The rest of the record's crap.
Yes.
This is the only part you play.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
I can't remember what particular song that was.
I do.
Well, tell me what it was.
Break Free, I Want to Break Free.
I want to break free.
You said all that part's no good.
It's all crap.
When they get into the guitar solo, that's the only... Then take it off after that.
And it's not a guitar even, at all. It's not even a guitar.
Well,
it's a synthesizer.
Well.
Then you take it off after that.
That's
an opinion.
That's
not being ignorant. And actually doing it because you don't know what you're doing. That's making a choice. That's a decision. That's a lifestyle, Sean.
No, I'll tell you what I hate. I hate people who dip songs at the end, fade them out and talk over the end of when there's another verse or something to go.
That's a sign of a real swine. That.
Yeah.
Yes. And people who I'm getting excited. Do you hear me getting excited?
Yeah.
Anyway, no doubt you'll think of others. I know your ego needs no further massaging, Jerry, but you are never guilty of over-DJing. Apart from when you've buggered up the timing for Wendy's Pips. That doesn't count. Wendy's Pips don't count. Down with this sort of thing, he said. I complained to Big Thighs Jerry Kelly about this when he was filling your slot one day, and he took the time to email back an apology to me.
Oh.
He's a very nice man, that Jerry Kelly. Not like other people who fill your slot.
Oh.
I know, that's what it says here.
Speaking of... Janice said that was hateful.
It was hateful, but I'll show the email. That's what's on the end of it. I'm terribly, terribly sorry. Right, I'm going to play a lovely record now. A while back, Paul Casey, singer-songwriter from Derrystoke, Londonderry, recorded a song. He wrote a song a long time ago called Big World. He recorded it just normally, and then he decided to give it a bigger, lusher treatment with synthesizers and one thing and another, playing guitar on it. But now he's done one better. He's gone to L.A., got a wonderful big studio orchestra, and he's recorded it. Have a listen to this. Turn this up loud. Turn this up as loud as your neighbors will permit.
trick shots play. Inside a nightmares, they don't go away. To the waves on the shore.
That's Paul Casey, Big World. What a fantastic record. I'm going to play that every day this week. You can Google Paul Casey on his www.paulcasey.com. Alan Simpson offers his apologies.
Right.
He said he is guilty of guitaris interruptus. I shall request treatment from the GMA. People may think it's Gerald Michael Anderson, but we know it's the General Medical Association. No point in apologising, Alan. The deed is done. What shall we do with the dagger?
A man wants to know who was Sandy Man.
I don't know. Here's another.
Remember years ago.
It
told the story of years ago. There was four or five brothers, and if a knock came to the door, one of the brothers would go out to the answer the door and come in. They would say, "Who's at the door?" And he says, "Sandy Man." And people used to say that all the time. Remember that? Who was Sandy Man?
Is that not something to do with the mummers? Come in, double out, get out, double out, come in, get out.
No, I remember Sandy Man Port. Do you remember the Sandy Man Port and the guy with a hat?
Orson Welles.
Yeah, do you remember that?
But that's nothing to do with it. It's nothing to do with it.
Sandy Man, who is Sandy Man?
I think Sandy Man has something to do with the old tradition of mummers, something with which we have been brought up, something which has been killed, I suppose, in the passage of time.
I never liked them.
You never liked what?
Mummers.
I never liked them either.
Oh.
Come in, get out, double out. Well, what did they used to say? Do you remember?
That's the only one we know. Who's running about this wee devil?
Who's running about this wee devil?
I don't know.
You always knew it was the guy next door, didn't you?
It was awful.
You always knew that. Anyway, we forgive Alan. Alan's a very good ear for music, actually. Amongst all the DJs in Radio Ulster, I think Alan has got the best ear for music because Alan likes his music and he knows his music. A gentleman talking about the Derry Jazz Festival, which apparently was an unqualified success. The way I'm starting to talk.
Yes, I heard that, unqualified.
Will I try that again?
If you so.
Apparently it was an unqualified success. Mm-hmm. That's the way everybody else talks. I should talk like that, shouldn't I? An unqualified success. And I'm sorry.
For God's sake.
Anyway, it was an unqualified success and only wrapped up last night.
Was it?
Yes. It seemed to escape you entirely. Did you feature the Derry Jazz Festival in any of your programmes?
No.
Did you mention it?
I think I may have.
You see, this is going on outside the door here. Uh-huh. Don't you think you should have got involved? It's because you hate life. Isn't it? It's because you hate life of any kind. I'm looking for a favour, says TJ Shields. I was out at the Derry Jazz Festival. How can you be? Can you be out at the Derry Jazz Festival? You can't be attending the Derry Festival. You can be participating.
No, out and about. See, because people were wandering from pub to pub, venue to venue. So you're out.
He was out at it. Okay, so that's correct.
I think so.
I was out at the Derry Jazz Festival on Saturday night and lost a black iPhone 4 somewhere between Shipka Street and Asylum Road in the city centre. I desperately need it back. I was hoping you could mention it. That was lost on your show. And ask anyone who's any information to contact the phone number. I've got it. Fingers crossed. If you hear someone who might have it. So we've got a phone number here. If you find an iPhone 4, that man needs it desperately. Back after the news.
On 92 to 95 FM and 1341 medium wave, this is BBC Radio Ulster.
At the news desk at 11 o'clock, this is Sabrina Sweeney. The head of the UK's biggest insurer, Aviva, Andrew Moss, has stepped down after shareholders voted against plans to increase his salary and that of other senior executives. The heads of two other major companies have also quit in the past month, partly because of a shareholder anger. American officials say they've thwarted a terrorist bomb plot. They believe Al-Qaeda in Yemen had been planning to blow up a passenger plane flying to the US by concealing explosives in the underwear of a suicide bomber. The American Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, said the foiled attack was proof of the continuing need for vigilance.
The device did not appear to pose a threat to the public air service, but the plot itself indicates that these terrorists keep trying. They keep trying to devise more and more perverse and terrible ways to kill innocent people.
David Cameron and Nick Clegg are expected to say they're committed to their austerity plan as a means of rebuilding the economy. The move comes after both the Tories and Lib Dems did badly in last week's election. Our own Finance Minister Sammy Wilson believes the Chancellor George Osborne will have to change track.
He is realising that the remedy is not working anyway. Secondly, there are going to be electoral pressures on him. And thirdly, there are going to be massive social problems on the government if they do not start to deal with the issue of unemployment.
The former editor of the News of the World, Andy Coulson, has been told he can challenge a High Court ruling that Newsgroup Newspapers does not have to pay his potential legal costs arising from the phone hacking affair. Mr. Coulson, who was arrested last year in connection with the hacking allegations, has always denied doing anything wrong. Well, it's time now to get the latest sport with Claire Glancy.
Starting with golf, Keegan Bradley has become the latest major winner to confirm he'll compete at the Irish Open this summer. The US PGA holder will join Rory McIlroy and Darren Clarke at Royal Portrush. It will be Bradley's first professional tournament in Europe. Boxing promoter Frank Warren is defending his decision to allow David Haye and Derek Chisora to fight each other in London this July. The pair came to blows at a press conference in Munich 3 months ago after Chisora's world title challenge against Vitali Klitschko ended in defeat. Steve Keane says holding on to as many players as possible is key if Blackburn Rovers are going to bounce straight back into the Premier League. The Rovers boss has refused to stand down despite the club's relegation last night and ongoing protests by fans.
Now to the weather forecast with Angie Phillips.
Rather cloudy with some showery outbreaks of rain at first, but brighter skies and drier weather will follow into the north and west for the afternoon and extend to many parts by tea time, by which stage there'll just be a few showers remaining across the southeast. Temperatures still slightly below average, but feeling pleasant enough in sunnier spots with just a light breeze.
BBC News.
BBC Radio Ulster. Travel news.
In County Fermanagh, the Killadees Road in Lisnarrick remains closed following a traffic collision. However, the collision on the M1 Saintfield Road onslip has now been cleared. In Belfast, temporary traffic lights on the Upper Springfield Road are still not working, and the A2 Belfast to Bangor Road is still down to one lane towards Bangor, close to the Devil's Elbow, because of a collapsed manhole. Finally, just one flight delay at Belfast International Airport. The 1 o'clock EasyJet flight from Alicante is now due at 3:15. Eileen Moynagh reporting.
Travel news on BBC Radio Ulster.
On Talk Back with Wendy Austin today, do you know what's in your bank account? On your credit card? Why are we so useless with money? And will the executives' plans to educate us help manage? It could take 2 years to bring in new drug driving laws here. Why so long? Then I've started, so I'll finish, the 62-year-old farmer who enjoyed the first leg of the marathon so much that he ran the rest of it too. Also today, The Voice. It's losing out to Britain's Got Talent. Is it because they're just too nice? And the path to true love never runs smooth. As Dave tells Nick, I never promised you a rose garden. Where did it all go wrong for the coalition? Talk back at 12.
I know it's on my bank account. I have it here. Oh, incidentally, congratulations to two local boys, James McLean and Darren Gibson, who are going to Poland with Trapattoni. Isn't that great?
Listen, I was right.
Were you?
Yes.
Yes.
I was right.
Well, maybe perhaps you could tell me what it is.
You need to apologise to me.
I'll apologise. I'll apologise to you if I feel the need.
What? I'm not here next week.
Are you not?
No.
Well, who is?
Well, I'm not here.
Well, are you not?
No.
Oh, it's bad for you. Somebody else?
No, there? I'm here the week after. I knew I wasn't booked in. Janice Book was right.
Well, who's in here next week?
Jerry Kelly.
That's all right then, so that's okay. Why are you making a big deal about this? Why do you demand
an apology? Because I knew I wasn't here.
Where's the Balmoral show?
Next week.
Oh, you're not here next week?
No.
Jerry Kelly's here next week?
Yes.
So in other words, on Monday, I won't be here and neither will you.
Neither will I. It's Jerry Kelly.
I apologise.
So do I. All right. One, two, three. There, I knew.
I got to talk over this.
Thank you. alright. Stars and they're all in line. Well, I'd say without even trying, everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright now. Can only shine when you're made of light. Everything's gonna be alright. It's gonna be alright now. It's gonna be.
Very good singer-songwriter called Jerry Hannon. Paddy Nash, my good friend from the Happy Enchiladas, gave me that this morning. I had a chance to have a quick listen to it before I came down. And Paddy Nash and the Happy Enchiladas have got a new album out, which I've got here. And it coincides with a request. A gentleman says, please play the song Muddy Waters by Paddy Nash and the Happy Enchiladas. Your brother Johnny is playing trumpet on it, which will be big news to my brother Johnny, who does not play the trumpet.
That's what I thought too. He's a trombonist, isn't he?
Yeah. And before that was, of course, Sweet Home Alabama by, what do you call them? For God's sake, I can't remember. Leonard Skinner, yeah. And I didn't talk over it. You know what I'm going to tell you? I'm going to say something now. This is a pleasure that very few people get to experience. And I'm going to say to you now that one of the greatest pleasures in this life is standing, if you're lucky enough to be able to enjoy this, standing on a stage with a good cover band and you're playing guitar at about 1 o'clock in the morning, somewhere preferably in Dublin, right, with a belly full of whiskey and a cigarette on the side of your amplifier, and you start playing ding ding doo ding ding doo. It doesn't get any better than that. It doesn't get any better than that. Anyway, do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Thanks. Yeah, yeah.
Jerry, you need to talk to Hugo. He talks over every song. What's not talking? That's just noise. Special request. Oh, hold on. Phone call first.
There's an update.
I know. Geordie, of course, we are very concerned. We were concerned, but we're not really too concerned about Geordie because we don't feel as if there's any cause for concern. We are upset, of course, that he has been injured in a way.
Well, there was.
No, we are upset, was never any real concern.
Yes, there was.
It was never going to...
You didn't show any real concern, but other people did.
That's because they didn't know the facts.
We did know the facts.
The facts being that Geordie burnt his arse.
The man was nearly...
When was the last time you heard of a man dying from a burnt arse? Come on!
I would have told you, the man had two skin grafts.
I know.
That's serious enough.
Well, you see, if you burn your finger and you get a skin graft, you know, it's serious, but it's not life-threatening. Do you understand what I'm saying?
It doesn't matter. Would you like it to happen to you? It must have been a terrifying experience.
I want to know why he didn't move away when his trousers appeared in imminent danger of igniting.
Emma said she'd like to get and thump you.
Emma?
Yeah.
Sure, Emma's not here.
She is. Emma's back now.
What happened to Janet?
Janet relieved Emma.
Well, I relieved Janet.
Did you?
Yeah.
There's an obvious thing to say now. Right. I'm not going to say it.
Stop it. Move on. Geordie's mate Francie is on the line.
I've always asked her.
Stop it.
Right.
Francie's there.
Francie's on. Okay. Francie, good morning.
Good morning, Jerry. How are
Francie,
you?
Francie, I know we're laughing and stuff like that, and we're not saying, and we're saying that Geordie, you know, it was not life-threatening, but it was an ordeal for him. And tell me, it was an ordeal. And tell me how he is now. He's doing great.
I was down with him yesterday, Jerry, and he's moved into a wee ward of his own and everything.
Is that not cause for concern?
No. He's brilliant. He got a haircut and a beard trim and everything yesterday.
What?
Oh, you wouldn't know him.
I'm trying to visualize
that. He's cleaned up and everything, look.
What does he look like clean?
He's brilliant.
I've never seen him
clean.
I'm telling
you, he's a different man.
Send me a photograph, will you?
I will send you a photograph. I'll take a photograph. I'm actually going to go down Thursday again.
I want to see that.
With a bit of luck, he may be in Craigavon on Thursday, but don't know. You see, that I was supposed to ring this morning, Jay. The doctors, they haven't done their rounds yet. He may go back to Craigavon for a day or two, just to build him up.
You know what I'm thinking? This burnt arse may have been the best thing ever happened to him.
I'm telling you, Jay, he's a different man.
Maybe a turning point.
He's even talking different. He's brilliant. I'll tell you, there was a wee lady. Now, this is a good one for you. There was a wee lady come in yesterday. She was from London.
Mm-hmm.
And they called her Geraldine.
Yes.
And she says to me, "You're so nice as no I'm as mate Francie." "Oh, I heard you talking to Jerry." I says, "Yes." She was telling me about her brother-in-law. Her brother-in-law was Dan some day in March. And, oh, God, he's made a brave recovery. But,
yes,
of course, Geordie being Geordie, says, "Lady, did anybody ever tell you you've lovely eyes?"
Oh.
So he's back to his normal self, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he seems to be recovering. Right then, okay. Well, you see, this is good. I mean, if he's cut his hair and cleaned himself up and shaved.
I'm telling you, he's brilliant. I walked in about 2:15.
Yeah?
And he was lying down in the bed and the headphones on. Who was he listening to?
Hugo.
And you seen a blame in the house, me and him fight because he'd not put Hugo on.
He was listening to Hugo. I was only joking there.
I'm telling you.
He was listening to Hugo.
He was listening to Hugo.
This is what happens when you wash yourself. You know, if things go wrong, the body rebels. All right, then.
And he's getting his toenails and everything done.
What? Oh, not that. Please.
I'm telling you, Jerry.
Next thing you know, it'll be watching under his oxters.
The next thing you know, he's walking about in suits.
Wearing underpants and everything.
I'm going to tell you, the house and everything's being dunged out.
I don't know, I'm worried about this.
Honest to God, I told him I'm going to have to go and have a look at the house myself.
He'll be starting to look for Jesus next. You know what happens to them? Once they turn the corner, they look for some reason to believe. Listen, can you send a photograph? Are you a type of a man that could send a photograph and send it on a computer?
Here's an idea. Yes. Excuse me, Francie. Excuse me for interrupting, but here's an idea for Jerry. Why don't you go and visit Geordie?
No, I don't want to see him.
Why don't you go and visit Geordie in hospital?
Sean, do you remember you were saying yesterday Jerry was doing something in one of the pubs in Belfast last night?
Tonight?
Yes.
Oh, it's tonight?
Tonight, Jerry's, yes.
Tonight, yes.
Right, well, I said to Jordy, I thought it was last night, so I said to Jordy yesterday, I says, apparently he's going to some pub in Belfast tonight. Now, Jerry, wait for it. He says, well, if he calls up, maybe I'll go with him. So I'll leave that with you.
All right then, but send me a photograph. I want to see. I want to see him.
Well, the only way I can do it now is take it on my phone. But the wife can put it on the computer.
Yeah, please do. Please do. I'd love to see that, and then I can commentate upon it.
Jerry, will I tell you, the nurses and everything love him, and he loves the nurses. I'm telling you, he's getting on like a house on fire.
He won't want to leave the hospital if he gets one of these signs and those nurses.
And he says he's being fed like a fighting rooster.
They're giving him grit.
I'm telling you, no drink, no smoking, no. You know, as you said, he may be looking for Jesus later.
Oh God! All right then. Okay. Thank you, Francie.
You're very welcome, Jerry. Good luck.
Bye. I'm worried about that. I don't like the sound of any of that.
Why don't you go and visit him?
Because I don't have time.
Oh.
I won't have time today. I'm going up to Belfast today. I have many things to do today. I'm a very busy person. I've got a poem here.
Showing your true colours now.
I've got a poem here. Brickland's burning. What a handling at the hospital when Geordie Tuft appeared, naked as a newborn babe with a grey Bin Laden beard. What happened here? The matron said. Was this man in the wars? A roaring inferno, Geordie slurred, destroyed my very good drawers. Next of kin, a wee nurse said, getting ready to make a note. Billy, wee woman, Geordie yelled. Billy, the buck goat. Is this man drunk? The matron said. Geordie roared, you are mistaken. This man, as you call me, is not drunk, but this man has drink taken. Put off a drip, said Geordie. The pain is kicking in. Put up a drip immediately and fill it with neat gin. A doctor then came running out to see what he could do. Geordie, he said in a puzzled voice. Geordie, is that you? I know this man, the doctor said. A firebug of renown, if it's flammable, the doctor said. This man will burn it down. Give me a Panadol, Geordie roared. This whole thing is a farce. I'll never see such a pantomime over a man who...
No.
Burned his arse. You've done more than that, the doctor said. Your burns are second degree, old Geordie yelled. I disagree. My burns are degree three. They pumped old Geordie full of drugs. They wrapped him like a mummy. A little tube was hanging out. It was a catheter below his tummy. When old Geordie came around, he looked around, searching for the cooking sherry. He had a lot to do today, but first he must phone Jerry. A nurse appeared. Geordie leered. He smiled and softly said, hello, wee dote. In the white coat, will you dung out my bed? A doctor stepped in, looking grim. To the Royal you must go, Geordie said. I'll see Jerry and drink cooking sherry at the Royal Balmoral Show.
Good.
Works of art. Ooh, yes, we are. to change. The credit union have sent them on a holiday. These are times of transition. Everybody's on a mission. We're living in a big museum going further apart. But we are all individual works of art. We are all individual works of art. We are all individual works of art.
That's Derry So Glendary Band, Paddy Nash and the Happy Enchiladas. That's their new album, which is called Times of Transition. That's a track called Works of Art. They'll be launching that on that album on the Friday the 1st of June and playing a gig in Bennigan's Bar in that very venue that very night. And you can see them coming up the Cellar Bar at Draperstown the 2nd of June, 30th of June, Black Box, and on the Eagles Rock stage in Glasgow Bury on the 21st of July this year. Nice people, good song, good musicians. Someone on the line here?
Sorry?
Sorry, I thought maybe you might have been listening.
No, I was picking my finger.
Picking your finger?
Yeah, there's a wee bit of loose skin, and I was tending to it. Sorry.
I see you're very busy in there.
No, I'm just...
Could you please say hello? This is a request. Let me just read this. Could you please say hello to our father, who art not in heaven yet. Our father, Willie Grant, who is 90 years old today, the 8th of May. He's originally from the Illies. You know where the Illies is.
Yes.
The Illies is a little, very famous kind of a townland just outside of Bunkrana.
Well, it's not very famous.
Cody Donegal. It is famous.
It's not very famous.
It's famous for musicians and all kinds
of
things.
It's not very famous.
Well, it's famous to me.
It's sort of...
Because my people come from the townland next to it, which is called Shandra. Mm-hmm. See, we all came from the hills, Sean. We came down from the hills into the city. Do you know what happened? Our mothers came from the hills of Donegal and they walked to Derrystoke, Londonderry, to try and obtain employment in the shirt factories. And there they met our fathers, who aren't in heaven. And then they begat us. And this is why we're here. We're here because women came down from the hills to work in shirt factories. If the women hadn't come down from the hills to work in shirt factories, I wouldn't be here.
How far did your mother walk?
14 miles.
Seriously, she walked from...
14 miles. First of all, she was hired.
Yeah, but she walked in... Did she walk in... She didn't walk in. But she walked in to get work, did she, or... What?
No, she walked in to sign on the dole.
No, but did she walk in and stay? What I'm asking, did she...
The first time she came in...
She didn't do that every day. That's what
no,
I'm
she
trying
didn't.
To...
She
no,
didn't.
No.
She didn't do that. The first time she walked in was to be hired.
Yeah.
See, people were hired at the Rabbles.
Yes, I know.
And in many places, there were three or four different, five different venues in Northern Ireland where you could hire help for your farm. They were the poorest of the poorest people. It was basically part-time slavery. It was basically white slavery. What happened was that you went up and you... My mother told me about that. And I talked about this before, but we'll mention it in passing. What you did, you went up to an area in Derrystoke, Londonderry, which is now called the Diamond, where the war memorial is. They called it the Rabbles. The Rabble? Was that it? The Rabble?
The Rabble.
The Rabble. Yeah, yeah. So then they stood there and she'd be standing there terrified. She'd be like 14, 15. And there'd be all these kind of things going on, like trick-of-the-loop men, con men, circus people, everybody around, everything. And you'd stand there and you had your bundle. You'd be standing with your bundle. And then a man with a watch and a bowler hat would come along, maybe, you know, and he'd say, "Oh, there's a young cutty there." And he'd look at your teeth and stuff like a horse. And she told me, she said, "You're like a horse." And then she'd, if you coughed or something, he wouldn't want you. And then he'd say, "Come on over here." And you'd come over and then he'd bring you over beside his cart. And he'd stand you there and he'd take your bundle. And say, "Stand there until I come back. I'll take in your bundle." So take the bundle and then he would bring the bundle into the pub with him. He'd have a few drinks and then he'd come back. But you couldn't leave your bundle because that was everything that you owned, you see. And you'd be standing outside in the cart and then he'd come back and he'd throw the cart, the bundle in the back of the cart and say, "Jump up there, you cutty." And she would jump up, no idea where she was going. And she ended up in some farm. And she did that on a number of occasions. Why did I start to talk about that?
I don't know, where are we now? Have you not got an email there?
Oh, yes, it's a request. Willie Grant, who is 90 years old today, the 8th of May. He's originally from we started talking about the Illies. It's a townland beside the place where my mother came from, just outside Bunkerana. He left 75 years ago to work on farms in Limavady. There you are. But he probably wasn't hired 75 years ago. No, people were still hired. I bet you he was.
Would have been.
I bet you he was. They were hiring up until about 1933, 34, 35, just before the First World War. His recipe for a long life is the following: a daily dose of Bushmills, several bets on the horses, and plenty of cigarettes. It's like my Uncle Manny. My Uncle Manny died when he was 90. I drank a bottle of whiskey a day and smoked 40 senior service untipped every day of his life.
But not to be recommended.
I'm recommending it now.
No, you're not.
It was all right for him. He was never sick in his life.
He's a one-off.
I know, but I might be a one-off too, and so might you. See, you must never assume that you'll never be a one-off. All these people saying, oh, you better not play chestnuts without goggles on. You know? Oh, for God's sake, all these people. What about the man comes in and tells us not to take risks coming down the stairs, tells us to hold the banister. Oh, you're taking a risk there. Hold that banister, you maven. Don't run on the stairs. Ah, wise up.
We're not allowed to run on the stairs.
We're not allowed to run on the stairs in the BBC in case we have to give us money.
What about your call?
Ah, will you stop? You're always ruining everything. Can't you hear me enjoying myself here? Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm not assuming that, I'm not implying that I wouldn't enjoy myself talking to you, but I was enjoying myself talking to you.
Well, you listen to yourself.
Thank you.
Where were we yesterday?
Where was I yesterday?
Yeah.
I was here.
What's wrong? You didn't do the marathon. It's too cold and damp for you.
I'll tell you what happened. Last year was
in your bed, were you?
Last year was a special year. I was I was collaborating with the fat boy. He was doing a program last year called Going the Distance, right? And he promised a year before to get himself fit for the marathon last year. So it became very evident as the time marched on that there was no way, because as he claimed to be getting fitter, he was getting fatter.
You're talking about something, I'm talking about you.
But I'm coming round to me in a minute.
Right.
Instead of getting fitter, he got fatter. So what they did was, they said, what are we going to do with this thing here? So they got me in to get involved in it, and I was narrating the programme, and they said, will you run a leg of that for him? So I ran a leg, and the fat boy ran a leg, and somebody else ran a leg, and I didn't want to run it at all. I don't like running. I hate it. Running is the worst thing in the world you can do, because all the time you're running, and I defy anybody to tell me different, all the time you're running, your body is screaming one sentence at you, stop running! Stop running! Stop running! That's what your body is saying to you. Whereas when you're walking, your body is saying to you, oh, this is nice. Isn't that what your body says when you're walking?
Yeah.
Body says, oh, this is nice. This is good. But when you're running, it's going, stop! 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 Anyway, yes?
Funny.
Are you? Do you think?
You listen to yourself sometime, by.
And I never do. If I ever listen to myself, I never.
You would turn yourself off. You want to listen to Sean Coyle for a change? Oh. That's beside the point. You're and all those poor critters are running around in the cold and freezing.
There's
no dolly birds there. If I'd have been there, you'd have been there like last year.
Well, plenty of dolly birds there last year.
There's another thing I meant to say to you too.
Yeah.
You said a while back you'd never wear damn jeans or that there. I saw you on Friday night beside the City Hall. You're walking around like a teddy boy.
Friday night?
Well, not like you should catch yourself on. And wear a decent suit.
Well,
You must have been a worn mount.
Well, I must confess that I try to keep up with the current fashions as best I can. But see, there's a certain way. You see, you can only go so far. I mean, if it is the fashion to wear a certain type of clothing, you kind of approach that, because, you know, I'm not at the age when I can wear a thing that a man can wear when he's 21. But if I can wear something near that, that means that I'm on the cutting edge. I'm down there with the kids. Obviously, you're not of that persuasion. Friday night, where was I on Friday night?
Another thing, you want to get that haircut of yours by.
What are you, a Christian brother?
There's an old woman running about there.
Sean, who is this?
You talk like an old woman too.
John.
I tell you, listen to Sean Coyle and play some of his records.
Excuse me a sec. What does he want?
Well, ask John.
I'm afraid to ask him. What do you want?
What?
What do you want?
I wanted to know where you were yesterday. You're making excuses there.
I was nowhere yesterday.
Bed.
I had never...
You're out there with those poor critters running about the cold or freezing wet.
I know, it's ridiculous. People, they shouldn't be out
there. You're a dry weatherman, aren't you?
I'll tell you what I spent yesterday. Do you want me to tell you what I did yesterday afternoon? I'll tell you what I did yesterday afternoon, and I regard this as being a far, far better thing to do than any man who ran 20 miles. I went home and sat down on the big sofa and put on the TV and watched Moby Dick.
I don't think he came out of the house yesterday.
Did you see that yesterday, Sean? Did you see Moby Dick?
Tell us, where's your taste in music? It must be your mouth. Not your mouth, somewhere else.
I think we'll have to leave this man. Go away. Thank you for calling, and thank you for your contribution today, which has been most enlightening. Go away.
You didn't like him, did you? You didn't like him. That man was only expressing an opinion.
I didn't like his tone.
No, you didn't like it.
It was too strident. He seemed as if he'd been a friend of yours. He sounded like that.
Wait a little while from now, if I'm not feeling any less sour, I promise myself to treat myself and visit a nearby tower. And climbing to the top, will throw myself off in an effort to make clear to whoever what it's like when you're shattered, left standing in the lurch at a church where people were saying, my God, that stuff, she stood him up. No point in us remaining, we may as well go on, as I did on my own, alone again, naturally. To think that only yesterday I was cheerful, bright and gay, looking forward to what wouldn't do, the role I was about to play. As if to knock me down, reality came around, and without so much as a mere touch, cut me into little pieces, leaving me to doubt. Talk about God in his mercy, if he really does exist, why did he desert me in my hour of need? I truly am indeed alone again. It seems to me that there are more hearts broken in the world that can't be mended, left unattended. What do we do? What do we do?
Gilbert O'Hulahan, alone again, naturally. That's good. Some messages here.
Yes.
Huh? I was lucky enough to see Leonard Skinner in Nebworth, England, many, many years ago, probably 1974, says a man reaching back in time, Peter Quinlivan. And says their version of Freebird was outstanding. Yes, of course. Your brother did play trumpet on that record, says Diane Greer. Right. That record, Paddy Nice and the Happy Enchiladas. Ask him.
Right.
He played, really? Well, I don't know. Yes, hold on a second. Of course, he started off playing trumpet many, many years ago, so he can still play a little bit. I didn't realize that. Also, what are you talking about
I'll
in
pass
there?
That on to Jerry, then.
Also, Jerry Hannon and Paddy Enchilada, Paddy Nash,
well,
are doing a double
Jerry
header in Bennigan's this Sunday
thank
night.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Was wondering if Jerry could play anything of the late Eileen Donoghue. I met and saw her at the Empire Theatre many years ago. What did Eileen Donoghue sing?
That's a good one. The Homes of Donegal.
Why he just dropped in to see you all. I'll only stay away. No, I'll tell you what you sang.
Eileen Donoghue, Blackbird of My Heart?
No.
Eileen Donoghue, yes.
What do you call the one about Armagh?
I know the one. No, Around by Blackwater Again.
No. Around by Blackwater, one fair county in Ireland.
Is that Eileen?
With memories so glorious and grand.
Was that Brady?
And that's, no.
Was that Eileen?
I don't know who it was. Anyway, this gentleman says he was looking to see a band called Toe Jam play many times in the Polytech in Jordanstown. It was my old band. We never talk about that band. It was a three-piece band. We
talk about it quite often.
I don't, really.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
I'm very proud of that band because we had an unusual honour. There was a place called The Pound, very famous amongst the punk community, where Light and all those bands, Undertones and all those bands all played. It was kind of a rock club, basically. It started out as a rock club, then it became a kind of a punk venue. It was in The Pound Loney, down, it's all gone now, down on Oxford Street, down beside where the bus station was. And we used to play there on a Friday night and on a Saturday afternoon and on a Saturday night. And there used to be people hanging from the ceiling. It was just incredible. And the fellow who owned that, and we're very proud of this, you went, you know, you ride down a Friday, you played Friday night, and God knows where you stayed. You never remembered where you stayed. And you played on Saturday afternoon, you played on Saturday night, and then you struggled home on a Sunday. The man that owned that, and I can't remember his name, I think his name was Peter somebody, he said, and I quote, that Toe Jam was the drunkest band he'd ever seen. I'm proud of that.
Well,
and I shouldn't be.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
I shouldn't be, but I'm proud of that.
You should be ashamed of yourself.
No, what he meant was the drunkest band I'd ever seen that could still function. Mm. Do you know what I mean? It's easy to get drunk, Sean.
Yeah.
But to be drunk and to still go through the motions, that requires real talent.
He's also did a bit of furniture removal as well, too. We'll not go into that, will we? No.
Yeah, we used to steal things. Parents used to talk about the Sandyman coming to the door at bedtime when you rub your tired eyes. They would say, the Sandyman would throw sand in your eyes and it was time for bed as your eyes were tired and itchy.
What about John?
Why are Jerry and Sean so cynical about the Derry Jazz Festival? We're not cynical about it. We're not cynical about it. No. I'm only saying to you that you should have covered it more. See, I get you into trouble.
I know you are. That's why I'm just saying nothing,
about
it. You see.
I'm not cynical about it. I love the Derry Jazz Festival. Yeah. I missed it this year because I wasn't here. But, you know, I love jazz. So the first thing, my jazz is my first love. If they bring some jazz, it would be great. Jerry, Mama Cass Elliott, make your own kind of music. Do you know, Mama Cass Elliott, I met Mama Cass one time.
Did you?
Yes, I did. And it was a very, very unusual thing. It was in Toronto, of all places. And I went to see Woodstock. You know the movie?
Yes.
The movie Woodstock.
I witnessed the story.
Myself and a little guitar player friend of mine, we went to see the movie. And we were coming out. And coming out behind us was the biggest woman I think I've ever seen in my life. And I looked around and I said to your man, I said, that's Mama Cass. And I went up to her and I said, are you Mama Cass? And she said, yeah, I am. And so she
yes.
I chatted her for a long time. She was quite nice.
Ach, that's not meeting her.
Well, tell me what is.
But I don't believe that for a second. Do you know she failed the audition several times for the group? Did you know that?
As a missing dog
and then
called...
she had an accident. She got she got hit in the head. Seriously, she had an accident and she had a serious head injury. And when she came back, she auditioned again. It affected her range and her voice.
It improved her?
She could hit that. She could ever note that he was looking for, whatever he was looking for in the group and the harmony, she couldn't hit it before she had the accident. And then when she had the accident, she came back, she tried again. He said, I don't know what's happening. He says, but that's what I'm looking for. That's the blend that I need.
So the blow that she got in the head improved her performance?
Seriously. That's a true story.
I must hit you with a hammer. appeal for a missing dog called Lucy, a small collie. Draws.
Collie?
Collie. What do you call it? Collie?
Collie. No, it's a collie. Little collie.
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 Cross black and white went missing last week from the Central Avenue in Port Stewart. I'm just reading out some of these text messages.
Well, what about John?
Would you wait? Geordie said. Did Francie say that Geordie was getting on like a house on fire?
I don't know.
Did he?
I hope not.
Because if he did, we missed it. Jerry, you've time to make money. Well, good friends are few and far between, and you just have said you've no time to visit Geordie. What does that say about you? Well, it says that I'm a wee shite, really, doesn't it? It kind of sums it up.
Eileen Donoghue sang A Wee Cup of Tea. What's that song?
I have no idea.
Nor do I. A Wee Cup of Tea.
Just imagine what it might be. Oh, sit down and have a wee cup of tea. It'll be water. Da-da, I don't know. I have no
cup
idea.
Of tea? No.
My granny was from Castle Finn and was hired as a farmhand and ended up in Ballymoney. Her name was Eileen Teresa McCann. We've tried to get more information on her, but to no avail. There's a person whose granny went off hired and never came back, basically, is what I can deduce from this. Anybody know a lady called Eileen Trasa McCann or had heard
How
anything
can your
about?
Granny go off and never come back?
Quite easy. You go off and then you don't come back.
But if you're a granny?
Oh, I see what you mean. Well, you see, your granny is... What is your granny? Your granny is your mother's mother.
Yeah, right. Your okay. Granny can't go off and never come back.
That's a very good point, Sean.
Did you read that right?
My granny was from Castle Finn and was hired as a farmhand and ended up in Ballymoney. Her name is Eileen Trasa McCann. We've tried to get more information on her, but to no avail. Maybe he means maybe he means auntie. No, that wouldn't be right. The timeline is wrong.
Probably.
Maybe she came back then.
Yeah.
And had a baby or whatever, got married, and then ended up in Ballymoney. Maybe they just lost track of her. I don't know.
No, I think it's...
I don't know how any of this works at all.
I think it's her time when she was hired out. They can't find any information about that. That's what I think it is.
Mm-hmm.
You've lost interest. Well, what about John?
A caller has two tickets for sale for the Dubliners in the Waterfront Hall on the 7th of June. Anyone who wants to buy those. Who is it? Somebody called who?
John.
Where is he, on one or two?
Yes. One.
John, good morning.
Yes, good morning, Jerry.
How are you, John?
And Sean.
Sorry for keeping you. Sean can't hear you.
Yes, good programme as usual.
Thank you. I don't know why.
Yes.
Anyway, go ahead.
I was going to say, you remember your friend from the Nuthouse Hen Rescue Group?
Yes, lovely people.
Well, she was interviewed on Saturday morning. It was either the John Toll show or one of those other shows on Saturday morning.
Yes, yes.
And she said that she had had to buy 3 eggs off the internet, new place to get them, because one of her chickens had got broody.
Yes.
Two of the eggs had hatched out as cockerels, and she named them as Jerry and Sean. Surprise, surprise.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, that's
and
nice.
Throughout the interview, one of them, a certain Jerry, cockerel named Jerry, kept crowing and crowing and interrupting them and interrupting. Surprise, surprise.
That sounds like Sean. He sure it wasn't him.
So keep up the good programming.
Thank you very much indeed.
Say a nice word to my mother, Marie, who's not too well at the moment, but recovering.
Okay, hope she does. Where does she live?
Oh, she lives with me at home here.
Good girl.
Right.
Okay, thanks very much.
She's only 94.
Oh, God love her.
All right, then.
She's got another 10 years left in her.
Of course, yes, of course, yeah.
All right, then.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. See, that's a nice man. You can tell nice people right away. The other way I know that you're not nice.
Thank you.
I can tell by a man's voice if he's nice or not. I played this the other day, decided to play it again. Joan Armour Trading, Starlight.
Everyone trying to be somebody, everybody trying to be someone, trying to be at the A-list party, but most times on the sidelines waving. Look at me, here I am, here I am, here I am, can't you see me? Sell your mother for a breakthrough, and your father if you have to. Communication is the backup plan. First thing is to get more notice. Less talk and a lot more action. Look at me, here I go. Here I go, here I go, can't you see me? Sell your mother for a breakthrough. And your father if you have to. Living the dream. See an outside chance, you gotta grab it and big up yourself. A little skinny kid with shining bright eyes, yeah. Don't give a reason to get yourself knocked back. You got a personality, is that no better place to start than right here, right now, yeah. Skinny kid with shining bright eyes, yeah. Don't give a reason to get yourself knocked back. You got a personality, is that no better place to start than right here, right now, yeah. Even if you see an outside chance, you gotta grab it and big up yourself. A little skinny kid with shining bright eyes, yeah.
That's good, isn't it? That's Joan Armour Trading at Starlight. Someone on the line here, last call today, I hope. No, I don't mean I hope.
That sounded good. That sounded good,
didn't it? No, I didn't mean that. I meant last call, I fear, I meant to say.
No. It's Orla.
Freudian slip. Yes. Orla, I'm sorry about that. I didn't mean that.
Good morning, Jerry.
I didn't mean that when I said that. Okay, go ahead.
Oh, you're fine. I'm very lucky to get in before 12 o'clock. Thanks for taking the call.
Oh, no problem. What can we do for you?
I'm just ringing, Jerry, to let you know about our next charity event.
Oh, go ahead, having, go ahead.
We're having a wee night for Tuesday's Child in Strabane.
Oh, you had a,
Friday night.
You had a great album out at one stage, didn't you, a CD?
We had a great double album of Irish music, yes. Snow Patrol were on it, and Ronan Keating wrote a new song, and Duke Special recorded a new song, yes.
I remember
that. And you
played
it to death on the radio, it was great, thank you.
I remember that well, yeah. You should do that again.
Yeah, so we were trying to speak to you there from East Africa when we were out in the famine zones, but we couldn't get a phone link.
Oh dear. Yeah. Oh. So go ahead, tell me what you're up to.
Yeah, we're having a wonderful night. We're having an evening of swinging jazz in St. Patrick's Hall in Strabane with a fabulous jazz band called the Met Quartet.
Yeah.
They were playing there in the Derry Jazz Festival there at the weekend, and they really are super. And the tickets are just £10, and again, we're raising money for children in war-torn areas, you know, so just wanted to give it a wee plug.
Okay.
And there's a late supper provided, and there's a late bar until 1 o'clock in the morning, so it should be a great night.
All right, then. So that should go well, then. And so do people just come along, do they?
People can just come along, yes, or they can get tickets over the website. The website is tuesdayschild.org.uk, or they can come along and pay in the door, and the tickets are £10. Really great bunch of guys playing. There's Michael Bradley on piano, Mark Bradley on voice and trumpet, Aidan Dunphy on drums, and Peter Doherty on double bass. So
and what's
really
the venue?
Jazz at its finest, you know. It'll be a really good night.
That's real jazz. When's the venue again? Where's the venue again?
It's this Friday night.
Where is it?
In St. Patrick's Parish Hall.
Okay. Where's
in
that?
In Strabane.
Okay, so we urge people to go along to that. So where else would you be going on Friday night? Hear a good bit of music for a change. Okay, love, thank you very much.
Okay, maybe you'll come along yourself, Jerry.
Oh, that's too far for me.
Well, thanks very much.
I'll be elsewhere, I'm afraid.
Really appreciate it.
Not at all. Bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.
Where are you on Friday?
Excuse me?
Where are you on Friday night?
I'm elsewhere.
Where?
Yeah, those Angels of Mercy used to sing and beg down in Pershing Square, L.A. Voices that haunted me and still do. Lost nightmare Jesus sounds coming out of the coins rattling in a cup. From two blind ladies. Mm-hmm. I was born in the City of Angels in the late 1940s, down on Hope Street, near Pershing Square and Clifton's Cafeteria and the Pantry, and all them old strip joints on 5th and Main. You know, tonight, White Fury and her twin 44s, Charles Bukowski territory, beat outsider America in the music that's been lost from that time, taken off the radios. You had to have been there. The backdrop is MacArthur Park and Hollywood Court apartments and racetracks. The old America when music still resonated through nightclubs. People gambled and drank and screwed and smoked. People went down to the border and sipped highballs and cocktails and went to the bullfights. The old America where the big guilt and political correctness and the chain stores hadn't sunk in so deep. I thought, you know, the best person to read these memories would have been little Jack Horton. He was a circus midget who actually used to drink with Bukowski back in the 1950s. Then I find out little Jack Horton's still alive and living in Gidtown, Florida, with all the old-time carnies and circus people. So why the hell do we need any fake Hollywood tough guys here? Here today, gone tomorrow, boys in masks, flim-flammers, magazine faces, we don't need them. Little Jack Horton was the king of the carnival, the voice of the great American Midway, a voice that sounds like ukulele icon Laughing Gas, the real thing. He's been shot out of cannons. He did the pass of death on a Shetland pony. He rode the four walls of eternity on a motorcycle. Appeared in movies like The Terror of Tiny Town, One-Eyed Jacks with Marlon Brando. And he wrote poetry. This is a true American voice from the sawdust backlots of the old world. I saw little Jack a little while ago, gave him some cassette tapes and a cheap cassette recorder, and asked him to read some of these pages on Charles Bukowski memories. Real low fidelity Americana, the way it used to be. Ladies and gentlemen, it's matinee time. Here's little Jack Horton.
As Tom Russell, Old America. That's all we have time for today. Back tomorrow at 10:30. Goodbye.